All right, everybody, thank you for joining us today for our history, our Goodyear County history break. Today we have Jay Owens, the city engineer slash engineering director at the city of Red Wing. And he is going to be talking about some of the design and stories about during the construction of the new Eisenhower Bridge of Valor. And if you guys don't know, we currently have a exhibit on the history of the bridge here in Red Wing from the time when it was just a ferry going across the way to the bridge today. So if you guys want to come check that out, we have that here in the lobby now through the summer. So be sure to come check that out with us. And then I am going to let Jay take it from here.
Hello. Thanks for having me on here, Paul. I've talked about this project to so many groups, but actually this is not the first time I've done a history talk, or at least to a history group, about the project. I was invited maybe a year and a half ago over to the Pierce County History Center, which is in Bay City, I think, and went over there and had an evening discussion about the history of the crossing here at Red Wing, and it was really kind of a fun evening talking to that group, and then looking at old pictures of the crossing, and you know, at the location here was originally a ferry crossing, and I'm gonna get up there and see your exhibit as well, Paul, and see if you've got some of that stuff in there with the original crossing being a ferry there before the first bridge being built in the early 1900s or late 1800s. So that sounds interesting. But my involvement, I feel pretty lucky, to be honest with you, to be the city engineer during a time when we've done some major projects in the community, including ripping up some of the oldest infrastructure in town with our work on Main Street in 15 and 16, and doing that work, and then the next year starting the bridge project in 2017. But my involvement with the river crossing here, the Eisenhower Bridge of Valor, as it's named now, started well before the construction. It actually started with the first meeting being called. I think it was in 2008 or 2009. I can't remember exactly, but it was had to do with the funding that was allocated to replace what's called fracture critical bridges throughout the state. And that funding came about as a after the collapse of the I-35 bridge in Minneapolis. It's interesting, we had in the early 2000s we had a downtown traffic study to talk about the issues that we have on our on 61 and 63. And at that time, with the downtown study, of course, all of our meetings that we held, people were concerned about how the Eisenhower Bridge and Highway 63 comes into downtown Red Wing, and how it comes in at the corner of 3rd and Plum there, and trucks are trying to make those maneuvers and it, and all of those issues. And MnDOT basically told us during that study is, well, we can make some adjustments to the signals and trying to coordinate signals, but the bridge, that the realignment of the roadway coming into town would not occur until a bridge replacement, which was not planned for many, many more years. So what happened, what moved that up, of course, is what I just said, was the collapse of the I-35 bridge, and throughout the state of Minnesota, funding was allocated to start replacing fracture critical bridges. And our bridge actually was the last one on that funding source to be replaced. Winona was just ahead of us. In fact, the Winona project manager moved up to the city of Red Wing to manage the construction of this project. So, like I said, it started, my involvement started very early on with that very first meeting talking about replacing the bridge. And just to give you a background on how that, you know, what are you doing in those first few years of talking about a major project like this? And we got a consultant on board shortly after that meeting and started what was called the preliminary design phase of the project. And with the preliminary design phase, it's really, you look at you look at all options. So where should the river crossing be? We know we need a crossing at this location, and the importance of this crossing to the city of Red Wing and in Wisconsin here, with about a third of our retail people come across that bridge. Our market reaches out into Wisconsin, and I think it's 35% or more of our actual workforce comes across that bridge every day to work in the city of Red Wing. So very important crossing, needed to be maintained during construction. So, we started looking at other options. Where do we cross the river? Where's the best location? And plans were put together, or at least preliminary sketches were put together, showing crossings that would bring it in near Bench Street by Wilson Oil there. And then other parts of touching down, maybe coming in at Broad Street near the YMCA. And as you've started looking at these different crossing options, there's, pros and cons to all of them, but it was really determined that the best place to cross was at the location where it is today, and where it was previously. And, the environmental impacts of a crossing at Bench Street were major on the Wisconsin side, going through wetlands and everything else that would be impacted, and the cost of that project. When we looked at a crossing that touched down at Broad Street, we felt that impacted our beautiful Levee Park way too much, that we had some assets that we didn't want to impact with the bridge at that location. So the preliminary design came back and showed the crossing staying basically in the same location near Barn Bluff. And with that, once we kind of determined that, the preliminary design started to look at, what should the bridge be? What type of bridge? Are we going to do something like Hastings, an arch type bridge, or is it going to be a suspension type bridge, or some other type of bridge design? And that's where a visual quality committee was put together to really dive into what should the bridge look like, what visual elements of the bridge should be enhanced, and what can we do to make this not only functional, but also fit the community and be an asset to the community and look, have some aesthetic value. And that committee, that visual quality committee, which Paul is now a member, Paul's on a visual quality committee that we have right now for another bridge project that we've got coming up, which is the bridge over Withers Harbor Drive near Perkins on 61. So not quite the same amount of funding would be available for the visual quality at that location, but with the river crossing, the visual quality committee put together a manual for us that really kind of dictated our designers to at the final design how things should look. And the bridge type was selected by MnDOT to be the steel tub girder design that you see, the large gray looking tubs that are called tub girders that are underneath the bridge holding up the structure. So that was taken on by our design team to add the elements, the aesthetic lighting, the lettering on the spires that indicate Minnesota and Wisconsin on the new bridge, the landscaping and the block work and the colors of the bridge itself. We're all part of that visual quality committee's work. The other thing I wanted to mention is, this is why the preliminary end of this and the design was so important, was that when MnDOT approached this with the funding that they had, they have to put together what's called a purpose and need statement, and their purpose and need statement to bring forward to the federal government was that the purpose of it is to have a safe, reliable crossing of the Mississippi River. And the need is because of the needs that I told you about at this location with the value of this crossing to the city of Red Wing. But what wasn't in there was it really just talked about the bridge. And as we got into this as the city, involved. We were really advocating that you just can't look at putting a bridge across the river and connecting to the existing roadways. We really said that another need needs to be, and a purpose needs to be attached, is the alignment and how the roads feed into the city itself and the issues that have been created with the larger trucks that are on the road now and trying to maneuver in our tight downtown. So it took a little bit. There was kind of some pushback on moving it to that level, that the project would expand to include realignment of 63 coming into town on 3rd Street. But in working with MnDOT District 6, they were very supportive of it. Our Rochester district were able to modify that purpose and need statement so our project could include more work, which added all of the retaining wall work and the realignment of the button hook that we have right now and the new signal on 61, and all of that needed to first be part of the project. So the project needed to expand to have a bigger footprint than originally thought of, and just building a bridge and connecting into the existing road system. So that was a hurdle we got through. We worked with MnDOT and got that through. Went through all of the preliminary design elements, started to look at how do we keep traffic flowing across the existing bridge and into Red Wing and build the new bridge right next to it. And there, that was challenging to really look at how that can occur. And I was part of a 1 week, toward the end of the preliminary design phase, I got asked to be on a team. Chad Hansen, the project manager, and myself were asked to be on a team to evaluate the preliminary design prior to being turned over to final design. And in that evaluation, we looked at all aspects of the preliminary design layout and the traffic staging. And one of the biggest things that came out of that week long, what they call it, as a CRAVE study, cost, risk analysis, and value engineering, I think. So CRAVE is the acronym. One of the biggest things that came out of that is we developed the staging plan. And like I said, Chad Hansen and myself were really the only two that were on the preliminary design team that were part of the CRAVE study. The rest of the individuals brought in were from different consultant engineers and different folks from MnDOT that really hadn't worked on the project. So it was good to have a fresh set of eyes looking at what the preliminary design was showing and areas where we could improve upon it. And like I said, the biggest thing was the staging of the project. And that staging plan that was put into the final design basically was developed in that 1 week CRAVE analysis that we did. And what we ended up developing was a stage where you build part of the button hook to begin with, to start with, and then what you do is tie in the existing Eisenhower Bridge into that button hook and put in a temp crossing across 61 to allow all of the work on 3rd Street and the retaining walls to be built while traffic is still flowing. But the first thing was to get part of that button hook done and start directing Eisenhower Bridge traffic to that button hook. And oftentimes you'll see in these, if you could just build this and go out and build this and not have to deal with existing traffic, those are great projects to be able to work on and not have to. A lot of engineering goes into actually how do you build it in stages and keep traffic flowing, keep utilities working. So we had to stage our water and sewer relocations to make sure that we were out of the way for this stage of the project, but we were still supplying water to Red Wing Shoe and all the residents in the 3rd and 4th Street area. How do you keep storm sewer working when you're staging a project? You don't want to flood out areas. We've probably driven through areas that don't seem to be, during a big storm, you'll have low points and stuff that are flooding, and a lot of times during construction, you don't have your larger pipes in place yet. So we had some flooding on 61 underneath that temp bridge because the storm sewer wasn't fully complete yet. We had some smaller pipes, so we had some issues with that during construction. But that staging plan was a big part of that Graves study, and it was really a needed aspect of the project to make sure that people were getting to Red Wing and people were getting back to Wisconsin to their homes, and because we basically said there's no way this is a detour type project where you shut the bridge off and start building the new one. So that was a fun team to work on that Graves study. So that was, like I said, that was right at the tail end of the preliminary engineering. At that point, we were wrapping up the preliminary plans, and the layouts were all done. And I mean, there was a lot of documentation along with the preliminary engineering, which gets into not only the layout of the project, but all of the permits that are needed. The permits from the Corps of Engineers, from the DNR, from the Coast Guard, as far as the navigable waterway, the permits from the railroad for crossing the CP rail tracks, all of your environmental documentation and permitting and all of that stuff is kind of done with the preliminary layout and preliminary design, and looking at all of those things. The fisheries, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife, and looking at the bridge for a flyway. We have to get permits for having lights on the bridge because of the birds and so forth along there. So all of that is done during the preliminary design. And now you have a set of permits and you have a layout that gets passed on to the next team that takes it on. And I was fortunate enough to continue on during final design as the city's representative, but it was a different consultant. SEH was our consultant during preliminary design. And then when it moved to final design is when it was passed on to SRF, another consultant, to actually take that preliminary design. And now this is when the nuts and bolts literally get figured out. It's every piece of rebar is designed out that goes in the concrete footings. The pilings are designed. All of the steel members and the bolting of the steel members and the sizes of the beams and the thicknesses of the steel and all of that is detailed out into a plan that is about that thick, you know. So, and what that plan and special provisions are put together and all of the details of the entire bridge specified. It is put out for bid, and that's the next stage of that, a couple of years of final design, and then moved into bid letting, and then Zenith Tech was the low bid contractor on the job. I believe the bid was, I think the engineer's estimate was around a little over $80 million for construction. And the bid came in at $63 million, so well below the engineer's estimate. And part of that was the steel, MnDOT figured that the steel from the old Eisenhower Bridge, at that time steel prices were up, and the value of that recycled steel, because the old bridge to be removed is the property of the contractor, and the removal of the old Eisenhower Bridge was theirs to sell on the market for recycle and making new beams and everything else. So that was part of the low bid at that time. So we did get a good bid on the project, and the project included not only all of the bridge elements that you see and the roadway that you drive on, but it included a lot of city elements of moving our large force main down along the gravel road along the river. Had to be moved out of the way to build the new pier. And that force main basically takes all of Red Wing's sewage to our treatment plant, which is east of there, down toward the Isaac Walton. So we had the large force main to move. We moved all kinds of water main and sanitary sewer lines up around the 3rd Street area and around ADM and behind Red Wing Shoe Plant 1 there. So all of that was part of that plan as well. And it was... that was all, like I said, bid in with the project. And then I stayed on during construction to be the liaison to, you know, changes come up during the construction of the project. We can't move the hydrant over there. We got to move it over here. We got to reroute water main behind here because we found something. And we found all kinds of stuff in the ground that you don't know that is there as we're digging through. And we found foundations of old buildings behind Red Wing Shoe Plant, Plant 1, which shut down the project for a while. It was kind of on an alignment where our water main was going. The State Archaeology Office came down to document what the building foundations were and taking samples and doing some digs and some pictures and things like that. So we found some old tunnels that connected kind of in that same area that connected probably some older buildings that serviced kind of like had underground tunnels to service the two different buildings. So all kinds of unknowns discovered like that when you're doing projects in old areas of town, you find that kind of stuff. We had tanks in the ground that we didn't know were there beforehand that had to be taken out and pumped and tested and made sure disposed of properly. It was the construction. It was a 4-year construction project. Like I said, I was involved through the construction as well. So when you look at my time in on this project starting way back, you know, it's been, you know, coming up on 14 years or something, 13 years of being involved with that very first meeting that the funding came through. So, like I said, I feel awfully fortunate to be an engineer in this community at a time when these major projects are being undertaken as this infrastructure from the 50s is being replaced, the 40s, 50s, and 60s is being replaced. It's been exciting time in the city of Red Wing, but also, you know, a lot of inconvenience for a lot of people, especially the Main Street job, probably more so than anything. You know, 2 years before the bridge started, we were working on that Main Street corridor from Old West Main all the way to Potter Street, And then the bridge started from there, and that was a 17, 18, 19, and 20 project. And just to let you know, we're not completely done with the bridge project. I do have a hydrant that needs to be repaired near ADM, and there's punch list items as far as what MnDOT has on painting railings and things like that along the new Eisenhower Bridge of Valor, along the pedestrian walkway, which I do want to highlight to people. I think it's a great, great walkway up on the bridge. I encourage people to take a nice day and walk up there and have lunch at one of the overlooks and watch the boats go by. Maybe even try to plan that when the river boats start coming in on July, and you can watch them dock there. It's got a great view of Levy Park from sitting up on the overlook. So encourage people to use that protected walkway that we never did have before on the old Eisenhower Bridge. If you remember crossing the old one, I think it was about a 2 or 2.5 foot little sidewalk with no protection, and the cars were right next to that curb line. And I remember it well because I used to fish the back channel when I was a kid and walk my bike across there. And I remember my parents saying, be careful on the high bridge, be careful on the high bridge. So one of those things that now we have a protected walkway, and it just feels a lot better to be up there over the river with that walkway that's in place. So yeah, that's kind of my involvement from the start through this final construction that we'll be doing a few things this year. But I guess I would open it up to questions, or if Paul has anything to add. If Paul, do you maybe want to talk a little bit about your exhibit that you've got up there? I'd like to see that. So
yeah. So yeah. Our exhibit, our curator is just kind of finishing up the last touches here, but like we kind of said in the beginning, it starts at like what it first started, like small ferries. And we even have some ferry tickets from that time. And then it goes all the way up to the current bridge. We even have a home video of the first Eisenhower Bridge being built on a loop here. So you can watch them being built. Just trying to think. Any questions for anyone in the chat? Well,
I'd like to add one thing that I went down for it, and I don't know if anyone else had done that or gone down there, but when they lowered the center section of the old Eisenhower Bridge, I was down at Levy Park, and one of the MnDOT persons was talking to someone, and it was on the other end of the park, but must have pointed to me and said, go talk to the city engineer over there. And it was two sisters and their husbands, but the sisters were the daughters of the MnDOT construction engineer who built the Eisenhower Bridge in the 50s. And I actually had, I had just read a bunch of stuff about him, and there was an article in the Republican Eagle that I gotten from, Yes, Marion Fitchin is on. Marion had given me a lot of old stuff, old Republican Eagle things, and he was in there, and I was reading about that, and then all of a sudden, a few days later, I'm meeting the daughters of the engineer who was the construction engineer during that bridge project. So that was kind of a neat thing. They were down there to watch that lowering of the center section. So
I should also mention we have a photo contest with the portion of the high bridge that we have out in the park behind the History Center, if you guys want to check that out too. Kind of a piece that's added on to the exhibit as well. So
that's you're talking about the first bridge across right?
That first railing. Bridge across there. We have a railing piece in back in the park.
Yep, and we will be getting you, it's being sandblasted and painted. We took a piece of the Eisenhower Bridge, and that's going to go up near that piece of the original 1900 bridge. So kind of neat to see the two bridge pieces, and then you can look down and see the third bridge from that vantage point. So.
Any more questions in the chat for?
Yeah, Jay. This is Todd Avery. Thank you for giving the talk. That was really interesting stuff. And I'm sorry I missed the first couple minutes, but is there a projected life of the new bridge? Do they have any thoughts about how long this one's going to last?
Yeah, that was, yes, they do. The Chad Hansen, I remember that was in our very, I think it was the groundbreaking. I was going to say ribbon cut, but at the groundbreaking, that question came up, and it is a 100-year design. That's what they put forward. So, you know, and I feel I forgot to mention this during the, but during the preliminary design, there was a lot of talk about putting a 4-lane bridge across, and why weren't we designing to a 4-lane bridge? But when you look at the traffic volume on our crossing at around 13,000 cars a day, we don't really need, the bridge wasn't the problem. It was really the way the roads connected into the city that was causing the traffic issues. The bridge was not the congestion point. That was different than the city of Hastings. They carry near 29,000 to 30,000 cars a day across the river in Hastings. Versus we're around 13 to 15. So we were really comfortable with a 2-lane bridge. However, to go to your point about being a 100-year design, what about 30, 40 years from now? We need two more lanes. So the idea was the location of the existing or the older Eisenhower Bridge would be reserved for another bridge to be built next to it that could carry two more lanes. And the button hook is actually set up. We had drawings showing how you could add the lanage down to the signal on 61 to accommodate more lanage, you know, more lanes across the river. So, so we feel we got a 100-year bridge, and if we need to add to that sometime in the future, we can add two lanes. So, good question, though.
Well, if no one has any more questions, thank you, Jay, for joining us today for our history break, and thank you everyone else for coming to listen. And I hope you guys have a great rest of your day.
Thank you. That was fun.